Okay, so I would like to introduce you to Tim Draper. Tim Draper in New York is one of the most important and famous VC in Silicon Valley. He has two main interests. One is California. He loves California so much, he wants to divide California in six Californias. And second, cryptocurrency. He is one of the most famous and prominent investors in Bitcoin. He actually even auctioned Bitcoin in an auction from the FBI a few years ago. And he has been in this space for like 5-6 years. I would like to say hello to Tim. Thank you for your patience. Thanks for your time.
Thank you. Very excited to be there virtually. I'm sorry I'm not in Italy right now. That's such a beautiful country. And there's so much interesting dynamic entrepreneurship going on in Italy. What I thought I'd do is I'd start talking about what I'm seeing happening in the world. And it all sort of stems from Bitcoin and partly from big data. Because you put those two technologies together and they begin to transform the world in a way that has never been transformed before. And you know what, many of you are entrepreneurs out there. And what I say to the students from Draper University about entrepreneurship is, to keep an eye on new technologies that could potentially transform industries that have gotten sort of fat and lazy. And just as the internet came and transformed communications and information, media, entertainment, and gaming, Bitcoin and the associated technologies with data and the associated technologies with Bitcoin have the potential to transform industries that are 10 or 100 times as large as the industries that were transformed by the internet. And so this is one of those absolutely tremendous sea changes in the world that we can all take advantage of. And it's going to create all sorts of a tumultuous time. It's going to create a lot of ripples and waves in the way people do things. It will potentially transform these extraordinary industries. And so let me go through first the technologies and then the industries that I think that they're going to transform. Well, first, Bitcoin created a transparent, open, frictionless, global, fair, and audit experience that can be used anywhere in the world. And so if somebody in Sudan is trying to is escaping and they become a refugee in somewhere in Italy, they're leaving Sudan and all the money they have in Sudan. They might be very wealthy in Sudan, but nobody's going to take Sudanese money in Italy. And so, but if they were Bitcoin users, they could just draw down their money and move right across the border. So, Bitcoin has created this currency that we have a lot more faith in than in many governments' currencies. The government currencies are all often subject to political whims or to big loans that the government has taken down in the past, or for currency manipulation, or a number of other fraud. All sorts of things happen in various governments. Well, Bitcoin is immune to that. It's completely decentralized. Anyone can work on it. Anyone can become a miner. And anyone can hold Bitcoin, and anyone can receive Bitcoin. The next is the blockchain. And that technology creates a perfect ledger. And with a perfect ledger, you can imagine that you wouldn't ledger keeps perfect track of every transaction that ever happens on the blockchain. That perfect track can be money or it's data. So this is another major breakthrough in potential change. Certainly change the field of accounting, but I suspect that it will change a number of other fields too. And as you keep perfect records of data, that also that data can be in effect guaranteed data. So governments are very interested in that. And healthcare records can be permanent, and many other industries are interested in that. And then there are smart contracts. A smart contract is basically a contract written in software. And if you write a contract in the software, it's set just that way. So you can that can actually change the nature of legal and how laws work and how people write contracts and how contracts are executed after an event happens. And then in the big data world, you've got all that data, it just keeps growing. And then people analyze that data, and that's called deep learning. And then they put some intelligence on that data. They anticipate what the world, what will happen in the world based on historic data. And that's called artificial intelligence. So put all these technologies together, and I'll give you a couple of examples of what that could mean. In my business, venture capital, you know, people say AI is going to take jobs. Well, I think it's going to take all of our jobs, and we're going to create new jobs that are more abstract and more interesting and more developed, and the world is going to be a better place, just as it was when we developed the hoe or farming or the tractor for farming or the automobile or whatever. I'm sure it put a lot of people out of work, but then those people created new work and new things to do. And that's the beauty of a dynamic free market. But let's say, let's put all of us out of business. Let's imagine venture capital. Well, with these technologies, I could raise a fund completely in Bitcoin. I could deploy it in Bitcoin, put it into startups like yours in Bitcoin. And then I could, and then you could pay your employees and suppliers in Bitcoin. And there would be, we would be, we'd put it all into a smart contract, and the money would be on the blockchain. And then think what would happen as you pay your employees and suppliers, as I fund you. All of that accounting is done automatically. And then if you sell your company, then I can then create a wallet for all my investors, and I can have that, the money that comes to my fund immediately get spread amongst all my investors. And there's no legal work done, there's no accounting work done, so the lawyers and accountants can think of better ways to help succeed. And in artificial intelligence, I could imagine that a camera would create a better detector of not only passion or excitement for a business, but it could also determine whether the entrepreneur is lying. I could defer to the camera, then my job is now abstracted to some new job. So starting with that, now let's go on to healthcare. Healthcare can be completely transformed because let's say we put all of our data up into the cloud, and once it's up there, then it's not just our healthcare records, it's our genetic history and our blood test results and Fitbit results and what we had for breakfast and who we've met and what conferences we've gone to, where we've traveled. All that data is going approach for diagnostics than any doctor could ever create. And so that, I think healthcare is going to change in a huge way as all medicine, all healthcare, all diagnostics are going to start moving toward being data-related, completely data-related. Data could potentially become a much better FDA. Data could do a better job of determining whether a drug is going to be good for you or bad for you. Healthcare is just going to change in a big way. And then government is another industry, and it's the biggest industry in the world. And it could potentially be bigger than anything else that we've ever seen. And what that means is that these geographic borders are going to fall, and we are going to be able to move. And as we move, just as a whole bunch of people seem to be moving out of the room, we have the ability to move to another country or to another place, and we can move physically or we can move virtually, and that could be an extraordinary event where humanity becomes a moves up to another level, where humanity is no longer tribal, tied to geographic borders, but it is one big globe. We're all interconnected, and I believe that that's happening faster than any of us ever imagined. I think it all came because Bitcoin was a decentralized currency. And so I believe that we've got one of the greatest entrepreneurial opportunities in the history of the world today. And as a venture capitalist, I am incredibly excited about that, because as you see all of this tumult, all of this movement, dynamic, dynamism inside and around people and governments, society, venture capital and entrepreneurship become great beneficiaries. And so with that, I think I have kind of used up my time, but I'm open to questions if you still have some time.
Yeah, Dave, can you hear me?
Yes.
So I have a question for you. I mean, of course, I agree that Bitcoin is a great opportunity. It's a revolution that is shaping the future of money. I'm wondering, what do you think about the different currencies that are being issued by banks or by companies like Facebook or JP Morgan?
Yeah, what's really interesting is that JP Morgan and Facebook seem to have. They both, JP Morgan bought off Bitcoin. They said it was a scam, they said it was they didn't allow their credit card to be, anybody using a JP Morgan credit card to buy Bitcoin with it. They then said that it was, they worked with government to try to make sure it was not used. And all of those failed for them. And so then they decided, if we can't beat them, they'll join them. But the difference between a JP Morgan, whatever they're calling it, and Bitcoin is that JP Morgan, that currency is centralized and ties to currency. So we have political currency. And people like Bitcoin because they don't feel as comfortable with fiat currency. If you're from Argentina or Nigeria, you don't trust your government currency at all. You're trying your best to get a hold of something else, and so Bitcoin could be that something else. And the centralization in both Facebook and JP Morgan, I think, are going to make it so that those currencies are not as valuable, because people are not going to feel as comfortable with a centralized currency once they recognize that a decentralized currency is more honest.
So, Tim, actually, another question for you. Is the fact that Bitcoin is actually a backup currency actually one of these things? Because let's say that I have Bitcoin and US dollar or US dollar coin, I would be for sure. So what's the basic limitation per se?
Well, I think that you almost made the argument that people should be using Bitcoin because you're using Bitcoin because you know it's a better currency, and you're holding it because you know it's a better currency. And we all know that it's more valuable than whatever it is today, because it's, and so we'll hold on to it. But when the currency gets to be $250,000 to a Bitcoin, or $500,000 to a Bitcoin, or $1 million to a Bitcoin, I think it will start stabilizing a lot more relative to people like you who recognize that Bitcoin is a much more valuable, much more effective, much better global currency than any of these things that are tied to a political currency. So I think it's just a matter of time, and so I think people are buying Bitcoin thinking that, oh yeah, things are going to grow bigger. And as more and more people use Bitcoin, it becomes more and more valuable. And I think that's just a matter of time. And people see that, and now with OpenNode and Lightning Network, Bitcoin, the blockchain, will not be an impediment to Bitcoin transfers. Because blockchain was fairly slow before, now these networks promise to be much faster than the Visa network, and so we will have no impediment to shopping with Bitcoin, to using Bitcoin for savings and loans, or all the things you use other money for. Bitcoin's going to be a better way to operate, and certainly to store value, but also to spend it.
Has anybody in the public had any questions for
So I'm not from the public, but I'm going to ask you a question anyway. Can you hear me?
You are from the public, you just done. You know, I think at some point our government is going to see the light. I know the SEC was set up in 1933, 1940, which is nearly a century ago, to protect the widows and orphans who were being taken advantage of by entrepreneurs. In my mind, I understand protecting the widows, but not the orphans. The orphans, I believe, are young, dynamic, and they should be able to, and if they are interested, willing to, they should be able to invest in startups. And they are startups themselves. You're in your 20s, and you're being protected from investing in startups. You are, you're stunning your ability to rise. And so I think that there is a big problem with these laws that have put limitations on them. Now, there is a crowdfunding, there's a Jobs Act, which did pass, but the bureaucracy slowed it down a lot. But we are using it in our show Meet the Drapers, where we interview entrepreneurs and viewers to invest in the market. So I am very optimistic that some government group will see the light and start to open up investment and allow the individual investor. master's to participate in startup. And I think, I do believe that we've got too much government control, and certainly in the U.S. I know in Europe it's a little looser, and you can do more crowdfunding investing. And that's great. We have a company called Gravity in London, one called Funderby in Estonia, and then both of those are tied to crowdfunding. Crowdfunding is a great, and I think there's a big future there. And that will change my business again. I love change because I like to get out in front of it. I know a lot of other venture capitalists are terrified by Bitcoin, terrified by anything that takes them out of their cushy jobs. But I like it, and I'm excited by what it can do for society.
Well, Tim, thank you very much. I want to greet you as Romans, ancient Romans would say, Avidim, Roma startup with a salutator. Like we used to say to emperors.